steer has pulled up another one with a great speaker. We have Ron Kirkwood that is going to be our speaker tonight. Ron is a native of Michigan, and he is a fellow Central Michigan University grad. I have my master's degree from there. Thank you, Air Force. He spent 40 years in the newspaper and magazine world, with a lot of time with USA Today as an editor and writer. Since 2013, he has been a Gettysburg Foundation docent at the George Spangler Farm. He's here tonight with his wife, Barbara, and he's going to talk to us about the George Spangler Farm. And it's a probably very, very interesting, and I hope you'll enjoy this talk. Now let me get it started. So you please welcome Ron Kirkwood.
Two hospitals on Spangler land. We're going to talk about the Spanglers themselves, and we're going to talk about Lewis Armistead. He spent the last 3 days of his life on the George Spangler farm in Gettysburg. So, George Spangler farm, you can see on the map, I hope you can see it way in the back. Move up on the sides if you can't. 166 acres. It's dominating the countryside behind the line. It's huge. It's close to the left flank, it's close to the center of the line, and it's close to the fish hook right end of the line. Then you have the roads. Little Grant Schoolhouse Lane cuts through right here. Blacksmith Shop Road cuts through right here. They connect the Tawnytown Road and the Baltimore Pike, the two main arteries. With this farm is big enough to hold massive amounts of infantry and artillery in reserve, and then use those roads to get them to the line quickly. This was a farm that could help George Meade win this battle. Here's a close-up of the George Spangler farm and how the Army of the Potomac used it. Number 9 is the Artillery Reserve, which we'll get to in a bit. Number 4 is the 1st Division, 2nd Corps Hospital. Most followers of Gettysburg have heard the story about the 20th Maine and Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain and other 5th Corps regiments who got to the line, got to Little Round Top just in time to save the day from the onrushing Confederates. But what they might not know is Chamberlain and the 20th Maine and the rest of the 5th Corps got to Little Round Top so quickly and just in time because they spent the day of July 2nd resting on next to the George Spangler Farm. They're right here. sit here until late in the afternoon on the second. Their orders were get to the front, get to the line, quickly go. So part of the fifth hustles down Grand School House Lane and make a left turn here, head toward the Round Tops. The rest of the fifth goes down Blacksmith Shop Road, and as some of you might know, it ends up right behind Little Round Top. They aren't gone long before the sixth corps moves into the exact same location on Spangler, next to Spangler. And again, they're not there long, and they're ordered to the line. So the sixth corps rushes down Grant Schoolhouse Lane, gets to the line. Later in the night on July 2nd, a division of the 12th Corps leaves Culpsville. Up here, they rush down Granite Schoolhouse Lane through the middle of George Spangler's farm to help at the line. George Meade had his main street at Gettysburg, and it was a little rutted farm cow path that eventually would be called Granite Schoolhouse Lane. Now, the 11th Corps Hospital, right here, around George Spangler's barn, other outbuildings, and house. Ambulances here in his wheat field, ambulances here, other 11th Corps ambulances up on East Cemetery Hill. This is the artillery ammunition train. They're supplying all of the artillery for all of the batteries of the Union. So they arrive with the artillery reserve on July 2nd with 24,000 rounds. The night of July 2nd, batteries are arriving in Spangler from all over the battlefield to reload. By the afternoon of July 3rd, they've gone from 24,000 rounds to 4,000 rounds. So artillery and infantry out here. And then Powers Hill. Okay, George Spangler owned most of Powers Hill. Nathaniel Leitner owned a small part of it. So George Meade puts, they have a signal station up there with the flags waving. They have artillery up there. They have infantry up there. General Slocum puts himself, 12th Corps headquarters up there and at the bottom of the hill. And then there's Meade. We all know he got bombed out of the Lydia Leister House on the Tommytown Road on the 3rd. It wasn't a safe place to be. Where does he go? He goes to the top of Powers Hill on George Spangler land. He watches the rest of the battle. He returns to the line after the battle is successfully won. Eventually makes his way back to Powers Hill, sets up his new headquarters right here on George Spangler land. There's a little woods there now. There's no sign like there is at the Leister House, but that was his headquarters on the morning of the 3rd and early afternoon on the 4th till the rainstorms sent him inside again. If you want to know where it is, if you're on the Baltimore Pike, the Slocum headquarters marker is right there. That's where Meade was. Now, we have one. This photo shows one Union battery, just one, and the men, horses, and wagons required to operate six cannons. There were 19 of these artillery reserve batteries crowding and overflowing Spangler land at 2 p.m. on July 2nd. So each of the seven Union infantry corps at Gettysburg had their own artillery batteries. And that total of about 200 cannons among the 7th Corps. These cannons had to go where their corps went, but the artillery reserve, this is a separate entity, they had 106 cannons, 2,300 men, and 2,300 horses, another whole third of power. Plus, the artillery reserve cannons based at Spangler on July 2nd and 3rd didn't have to go where an infantry corps went. They were crucial utility players who could be counted on to perform well anywhere they were plugged in the line. And that's exactly what Meade and Artillery Chief Henry Hunt did on the last 2 days of the battle. They rushed cannons from Spangler to the line, often with only a few moments to spare. They sent the artillery reserve from Spangler out to the peach orchard. They fought all over the Trostle farm. on Cemetery Hill. Artillery Reserve was on East Cemetery Hill. And the Artillery Reserve even fought on the Spangler's own Powers Hill. Other farms saw a lot more combat than the George Spangler farms. Other farms were literally destroyed by that combat. But based on what everything I've talked about here, no farm, not a single farm, set up the Union victory at Gettysburg like what the George Spangler farm provided for George Meade. Most of you know this image, the dead horses at the Trossel Farm. These are 9th Massachusetts Battery horses. They're part of the Artillery Reserve. They were killed on July 2nd after they were sent out from Spangler. So they spent the day at Spangler, ended up here. Sadly, this is what happened to the 9th Massachusetts Battery horses after they left Spangler. Grant Schoolhouse hosted the first and the smallest hospital on the George Spangler farm. The 1st Division caught the heaviest of the blow. Many killed and wounded were the result, and the latter are now being brought to the hospital in great numbers. Grant Schoolhouse Hospital surgeon in charge, Dr. William Warren Potter, 57th New York. Grant Schoolhouse was built in the early 1860s when the Spanglers donated the land in the middle of their farm for it. On days 2 and 3 of the battle, there was a major 1st Division 2nd Corps Army of the Potomac Hospital in the fields and woods around this school. This hospital has received little attention since the battle, and little had been revealed about it until my book came out, and I think that's a shame. It's just overgrown, unmarked land now with thorns and poison ivy that make it difficult to enter, as shown in the bottom left photo. But this hospital hosted the 1st Division, 2nd Corps, wounded and dying men who fought at Rose Woods and who fought at the Wheatfield, two of the most important places on the battlefield. These were the fighters of the famous Fighting Irish Brigade. This was the division of Father William Corby, who granted these men general absolution moments before the day of battle, thus clearing their path to heaven. This was the Corps of General Winfield Scott Hancock. With more than 1,000 men of the 1st Division were casualties on just that one day of fighting, and by the end of July 2nd, most of these men were either at this 1st Division 2nd Corps Hospital at Grant Schoolhouse on the George Spangler Farm, or they were waiting to be taken there. Chaplain John Henry Wilbrand Suckenberg of Erie and the 145th Pennsylvania served at the Grant Schoolhouse. He said, "Our hospital was at the foot of Powers Hill. I found the doctors and nurses busily engaged with the wounded scattered around in all directions, some lying on blankets, some on straw, a few on stretchers, others on the bare ground. Private Erastus Allen of Company G, shot through the abdomen, suffered terribly. Some of the intestines protruded through the wound, and some of their contents would occasionally flow out, producing a horrible stench. It was very evident that our regiment had again suffered severely." Second Corps Ambulance Chief Lieutenant Thomas Livermore made numerous deliveries to Grant Schoolhouse on July 2nd. He said, "Here under the shelter of some boulders lay a large number of our wounded and dead who had been brought from the field. They lay upon the ground covered with their blankets, and the living were nearly all silent, having fallen asleep from fatigue." Brigadier General Samuel K. Zook treated at the school on July 2nd for a massive chest wound before dying in house farther behind the line on day 3rd. His wound opened such a gaping hole in his chest that the doctor could see his heart beating. The monument on Wheatfield Road at the top left of the page marks where General Zook was mortally wounded. Colonel Edward Cross, 5th New Hampshire. In case you can't see, General Cross died July 2nd at Granite Schoolhouse after being mortally wounded on the opposite side of the wheat field from General Zook. Cross Avenue between Devil's Den and the wheat field bears his name. Colonel Cross was beloved as a great fighter in New Hampshire and by many of his men, but he was despised by others for his drinking and his temper tantrums, and his unit's pioneer corps called him a tyrant, and they refused to bury him at Gettysburg. The monument in the middle of the page honors Colonel Cross and his fighters. Lieutenant George A. Woodruff, 1st United States Artillery Battery I, mortally wounded on July 3rd during Pickett's charge when he was hit in the back while facing and directing his men at Ziegler's Grove. He is the son of a Michigan judge. He died at Granite Schoolhouse, telling his friends that he regretted being shot in the back and asking that it should be no reflection upon his reputation. Most of the 1st Division 2nd Corps Hospital at Granite Schoolhouse was moved to safety farther behind the line on day 3 after 24 hours of intense service because it was getting hit by Confederate artillery overshots from the 3 Pickett's Charge cannonade. Before I get into the next hospital, there was an open field next to the schoolhouse, and that's where they actually placed the wounded men and didn't put them in the school. 2nd Corps medical officers used that. That was an open field. They're doing the surgeries, they're doing the amputations in an open field, maybe under some trees. That open field is gone. It's all woods now. There's no markings. The National Park Service says it would be too expensive to clean it up because it's not on the battlefield. I just think it's a real shame and a real loss that this hospital is there to be marked, and it's not a priority. Excuse me. One day cured me of a hospital. Give me the picket line every time in place of a hospital. Captain Matthew B. Cheney, 154th New York, after visiting the 11th Corps Hospital at the Spangler's Farm. The 11th Corps medical staffers picked the Spangler's Farm for a hospital on July 1st because of its proximity to the evolving front line, access to water, crops and livestock for food, buildings for hospital purposes, good roads, wood for operating tables, tents, fires, and caskets. So while the 1st Division 2nd Corps Hospital used the school on Spangler land, the 11th Corps Hospital used the Spangler's house, barn, and other outbuildings, and summer kitchen. George Spangler was 47 years old during the battle. His wife Elizabeth was 44. Their kids, all of whom were living at home, were Harriet, 21, Sabina, 19, Daniel, 17, and Benaiah, 14. So the 6 Spanglers are ordered by 11th Corps doctors on July 1st to either leave, get out of the way for their own safety, or stay together in one upstairs bedroom of their house, and they chose the bedroom. They could leave the room for the 5 weeks and 2 days that their farm was occupied. But in doing so, they had to step around and over wounded and dying Union officers because it was the officers who were treated in their house. The ambulance corps started delivering 11th Corps wounded to Spangler at about 4 o'clock on July 1st. At the hospital's peak attendance on July 4th and 5th after the battle, the sanitary and Christian commissions estimated there were about 1,900 wounded men there. And from my references and my review, I think there were between 50 and 75 Confederates at this hospital out of 1,900. Dr. Daniel G. Britton, Westchester, Pennsylvania, said, "The wounded soon began to pour in, giving us such sufficient occupation that from the 1st of July to the afternoon of the 5th, I was not absent from the hospital more than once, and then but for an hour or two. Very hard work it was too, and little sleep fell to our share. 4 operating tables were going night and day. Many of them were hurt in the most shocking manner by shells. My experience at Chancellorsville was nothing compared to this, and I never wished to see such another sight. For myself, I think I never was more surgeries and the amputations took place under the floor bay of the Spangler's barn. Doctors could have more light there, more fresh air there, away from the smells and the crowds inside of the barn. Surgeons worked here with their backs up against the wall. A surgeon could finish an amputation in 5 to 15 minutes, depending on the limb, and then move immediately on to the next one. No washing required of bloody or germ-infested hands or bloody equipment, because they didn't understand how proper sanitation could prevent infection and reduce the spread of disease. A Spangler surgeon approaching total exhaustion called the work too much for human endurance. Private William Salverton, age 19, 75th Ohio, he said, "At the doorway, I saw a huge stack of amputated arms and legs, a stack as high as my head. The most horrible thing I ever saw in my life. I wish I had never seen it. I sickened." Amputated limbs were eventually loaded into a wagon and buried somewhere in a distant location on the farm. The amputations and surgeries and wounds attracted an infestation of flies that relentlessly harassed everyone. Pigeons in the barn added to the filth, and hornets added to the pain. Then there were the maggots that covered wounds and stumps, which the doctors actually eventually figured out the maggots were good because they ate only the dead tissue. They helped clean up the wounds. Infections were expected after a Civil War surgery, and the worst infections could be smelled 8 to 10 feet away. So imagine the stench walking into the barn or into a tent with 8 to 10 men suffering from infections. To help battle these smells, hospital workers at Spangler cut down pine branches, and then they hung them up inside the tents, and then they used them for bedding as kind of a natural air freshener. Pennsylvania bank barns are big in Pennsylvania, with the four bay, 7 foot four bay on the front and the bank leading up to the top floor in the back. Are there any around here? Are there? I didn't know if they come down here.
I've seen them.
Okay. I've seen them down driving down 81, like toward Rowan. When you drive around the battlefield, you can't miss them. They're everywhere on the battlefield. This style is brought over by the Swiss and the Germans in the 1700s and the 1800s. Adams County, where Gettysburg is kind of the heartbeat of them, but you can see they go all the way up toward the Allentown area. There's some Pennsylvania bank barns in northwest New Jersey, down in Maryland. I've seen a bunch of them driving down 81 toward Roanoke. I've seen a bunch of them driving out the Pennsylvania Turnpike toward Pittsburgh. I think they're a grand design. I'm surprised they're not used all over the country. I think they're just really, really functional. But men were crammed so closely together in the Spangler's barn that it caused the spread of diseases. Some men died in their barn of the disease that they got in the barn rather than the battle wound that brought them to the hospital. All of this hospital was horrific. All of this barn was horrific. But it was the worst under the forebay where the amputations took place, and just inside that front wall in the stable. That's where many of the worst cases were waiting their surgery and the cries of agony, smells of infection, body fluids, and human feces. Blood dripped from the top floor of the barn onto wounded and dying soldiers in the bottom floor. Cries and screams could be heard 50 yards away in the Spangler's house. Hospital workers covered their head at night with a pillow in an attempt to try to fall asleep. These gruesome hospital and work conditions drove many surgeons out of the Civil War. Nurses read scripture and prayed with the men in an attempt to help send them on their way. Outside in the Spangler fields, the Army didn't provide enough hospital tents or food or bedding or clothes for the first several days, because Generals Meade and Hancock banned hospital wagons to Westminster to allow the roads to be free for faster troop movement. This multiplied the misery of the wounded and dying men at Spangler and other hospitals, who were forced to lie in the Spangler hospital worker, 153rd Pennsylvania, from up in the Allentown area. He said, hundreds were lying with but feeble, or in most cases with no shelter, exposed to a cold, incessant rain against the sides of the barn and in an orchard adjoining the sheds. Their moans were heard in every direction, and with a lantern I moved about from one to another during the long hours of the night. I searched in vain for blankets to cover the suffering and dying. Two female nurses played key roles at Spangler. Marilla Hovey and her 17-year-old Frank traveled with her husband, Dr. Bleeker Lansing Hovey, of the 136th New York. She was always one of the first to reach the hospital during a battle. Sadly, no photos of Mrs. Hovey have been found today, but my fingers are still crossed that we can find one. The Hoveys are the only surgeon's family known to have traveled together during the Civil War. Mrs. Hovey nursed the wounded, wrote home to family members of the dead and dying. She was able to go into sort of an autopilot mode, look past their terrible wounds and suffering, and hold the hands of dying soldiers and talk to them in a desperate attempt to get their mind off their agony and their situation. In one letter from Spangler, Mrs. Hovey informed the family of their son's death, and she told them, I have had a good deal of care of him, called him my soldier boy, tried to take the place of mother, sister, and friend. I think I never had such a trial parting with one that I had no more acquaintance with. The Hovies worked at the Spangler Hospital for the entire 5 weeks and 2 days it was open, and they returned to New York for 3 weeks to recover. Nurse Rebecca Lane Pennypacker Price. She was from Phoenixville, which is outside of Philadelphia. Rode to Gettysburg from Baltimore on a bench in a railroad cattle car in the middle of the night with donations after the battle. Then she went to work as an unpaid nurse at Spangler. She said, the sad scenes would fill a volume. So many times at night I lay on my stretcher weeping instead of sleeping. Captain Augustus Vinos, 107th Ohio, wounded on July 1st on what is now known as Barlow Knoll. Gangrene developed, his right arm was amputated above the elbow at Spangler. Mrs. Price nursed him from near death until he was well enough to take a train home to Canton. He went on to marry in 1866, have 9 children, many grandchildren, while amassing substantial wealth as a businessman. He was a pallbearer at the funeral of close friend, President William McKinley. Vinos carried Mrs. Price's photo for 40 years after the war. He often showed her photo to fellow ex-soldiers at national encampments in an attempt to find her and thank her for her tender care at Spangler. But he had no luck, 40 years no luck. But finally in 1906, he received a letter. Dear sir, do you remember the tall nurse at Gettysburg who furnished you with clothing so that you could go home? She had found him. Vinos replied that he looked forward to seeing her with great pleasure, and their reunion took place at a GAR encampment in New York State in 1906, 43 years after they met at the Spangler's farm. This is my wife, Barb. She goes on a lot of my research trips with me, and she helps me out. We spent a week up at Cornell University in Ithaca, New York. We went through 19 boxes, or some of the filthiest, falling apart paper boxes. The paper and the dirt would get in on your skin and in your nose. In fact, when we were done that week, Cornell declared those boxes hazardous materials. And you can only get those boxes out now if you're wearing a hazmat suit. So I think I got the last research out of those 19 boxes. Now, we were there to research the 154th New York. 154th New York had surgeons in Spangler, they had hospital workers there, they had injured, and they had dying men at Spangler. But here's what, and I got a lot on it that I use, I've got more than I'm going to use down the road. Even better, those guys were all there when General Armistead arrived. They were there when he was brought to the farm, and they wrote about it, and they talked about it, and underneath all that dust and all that mess, I found their writings and their interviews and their letters about General Armistead arrived. So I, so fortunately, so luckily, stumbled into materials on Armistead that nobody else has ever done. So I got a chapter in my book just on Armistead, filled with new information from the 154th New York guys, who I will always be grateful for. Armistead lingered through the 4th, died on the 5th, leaving an example of patriotism, heroism, and devotion to duty, which ought to be handed down through the ages. Colonel Raleigh Martin, 53rd Virginia. So Armistead began the final walk of his life in what would become known as Pickett's Charge on the Henry Spangler farm. He would die 2 days later on the farm of Henry's half-brother, George Spangler. Armistead arrived at George and Elizabeth Spangler's farm at dusk on July 3rd, 1863, according to Dr. Henry Van Arnum of the 154th New York. Armistead arrived in an ambulance. He was removed on a stretcher, placed on the ground next to the ambulance and near the Spangler's barn. 11th Corps Hospital workers, Private Emery Sweetland and Private Edson Ames of the 154th New York, described Armistead's appearance as pretty bloody and covered with blood. Sweetland heard Armistead, as he lay on the stretcher, say, "You have a man here who is not afraid to die." So the Spangler's property at this point, after Pickett's Charge, is a shoulder-to-shoulder mass of confusion, because this is the biggest hospital on the Union, the closest to the Union side at the end of Pickett's Charge. It's a mass of confusion, agony, crying when Armistead arrives. Hundreds of wounded from Pickett's Charge are pouring in as understaffed and overwhelmed surgeons desperately try to find who could be saved with immediate attention. Even so, the arrival of the Confederate general turned heads. Hospital staffers and most wounded had no idea of Armistead's historic courage that day, but they were still drawn to him, and a large crowd of workers and gawkers formed around his stretcher, circling Armistead. The crowd was finally broken up when Dr. Henry Van Arnum of the 154th New York arrived at Armistead's side and ordered that he be carried away for treatment. So he and First Lieutenant T.C. Holland of the 28th Virginia from the Lynchburg area, he said they were placed in the orchard. Lieutenant Holland said at one point under the trees that Armistead asked the doctors and nurses working around him to please don't step so close to me. Dr. Van Arnum described Armistead as wild, nervous, flighty, saying, "War must cease, men of same blood," and he could not live. Spangler patient Private Justice Silliman of the 17th Connecticut described the 46-year-old Armistead as rather past middle age. Private Sweetland said Armistead had gray hair and whiskers. Dr. J. Kling of the 55th Ohio said that Armistead was suffering intense pain induced by the wound. Stimulants and painkillers were immediately given him. Dr. Britton took time to get to know Armistead, calling him a fine man, intelligent and refined. He said, "I had considerable conversation with him and was much pleased with his manners and language." Armistead died July 5th in the summer kitchen, the separate building next to the Spangler's house right there. Lieutenant Holland of the 28th Virginia said that Armistead suffered intensely at the end of his life, and he died about 9 a.m. on July 5th. Armistead's body was wrapped in a blanket month later, he was exhumed by an embalmer from Philadelphia seeking to make money off his body. So Armistead was dug up after a month in the summer in a coffin. His body was embalmed in whatever condition it was in after that month. And then his body was reburied in the Spangler's orchard. Then in October, Armistead relatives paid the price for whatever the embalmer wanted. They put him on a train and they buried him in downtown Baltimore in a family area. Old St. Paul Cemetery, and if any of you are familiar with downtown Baltimore, Armistead is buried about 3 or 4 blocks from Orioles Park at Camden Yards. So I have confirmed and listed the names, wounds, and treatment of 1,441 Union and Confederate men at Spangler at their hospital, and the names of 141 men who were buried in their peach and apple orchards. The Union men were exhumed after a few months after the battle and reburied in Soldiers National Cemetery. Most Confederates other than Armistead lay in Gettysburg until 1872, when they were exhumed and reburied across the South. 11 Virginians with their wounds and treatment at Spangler are listed in my book, and almost 50 Confederates altogether. All of the Virginians lived except Armistead, who was one of 5 Confederates known to have been buried at Spangler. 50-year-old Colonel Elijah Sherrill, the 126th New York, died in Spangler's house. His funeral in Geneva drew lines of people that stretched several blocks. His image is on the monument to the 126th New York in Ziegler's Grove. Assistant Surgeon William S. Moore, 61st Ohio, died in Spangler. Amazingly, he was the only Army of the Potomac surgeon or assistant surgeon to die in Gettysburg. He left behind 1-year-old and 2-year-old children and a grieving widow who mourned for the rest of her life and never remarried. Colonel Francis Mahler, 75th Pennsylvania, died in the Spangler's house. The Philadelphia City Council honored him with a resolution and paid for his funeral. His brother, 2nd Lieutenant Lewis Mahler, died on the battlefield on July 1st at about the time and place of his brother's mortal wounding. Sergeant Nelson W. Jones, 3rd Maine, 3rd Corps, died in Spangler after being hit in both legs in the peach orchard by an artillery shell. He died even though he made and applied tourniquets to his legs on the battlefield. He was 20 or 21 years old. Does anybody know who George Nixon is? Private George Nixon III?
Richard Nixon's grandfather.
Great-grandfather. Very good.
Close enough.
Usually I don't get many correct guesses on that, so that was good. Private George Nixon of the 73rd Ohio died at Spangler. He would become the great-grandfather of President Richard M. Nixon. George Nixon was 40 years old. He had 9 children, and he was working a farm that he ran. He was a poor man, and I am convinced he enlisted just to make money to support his family. And his eyes here are some of the saddest enlistment photo eyes I've seen in a while. He died at Spangler. Adjutant First Lieutenant Joseph Heaney, age 21, 157th New York, died of a leg wound at Spangler. Nurse Price walked next to his stretcher and held an umbrella over him to protect him from the July sun as he was being carried to the Spangler barn for an amputation. First Lieutenant Thomas Wheeler, 75th Ohio, age 25, spent almost a month at Spangler before he died of 4 wounds. His parents were at his side, and Nurse Price sang Rock of Ages to him as he died. Many soldiers didn't tell the whole story of the series. One soldier died in Spangler one day before his grief-stricken father reached his side. Another died a few days before his wife reached Spangler. They both found out about their loved one's death when they arrived at Spangler. Corporal Andrew Mayberry of the 20th Maine died at Spangler, leaving behind wife Hannah and five children ages 6 months to 11 years. But, and this is a very, very big but, thanks to Civil War medicine, the vast majority of these guys lived. You figure there's 1,900 wounded at this hospital, and they buried about 140, 150 there. Many went on and died elsewhere, but the percentages were still strong here that these guys were going to live. So, examples, Captain Alfred E. Lee of the 82nd Ohio, he goes home from Spangler with a hip wound. He gets off the train in his hometown. He picks up a newspaper, and what's he see? His obituary. He reads it. His funeral is going on right now. He walks in on his funeral. Brigadier General Francis Barlow spent a week at Spangler with his wife tending him there, with three wounds that numerous doctors declared to be mortal. But he survived all of them and he lived. Corporal James Brownlee, 134th New York, survived seven gunshot wounds at the Brickyard on July 1st, one of which broke four ribs. He was shot three times through the bowels and he still lived. That was unheard of in Civil War medicine. Private Justice Silliman of the 17th Connecticut was knocked out by a shell to the head on July 1st. He was taken to three different Confederate hospitals in Gettysburg before arriving in Spangler on July 4th. He healed and he became a nurse at Spangler and Camp Lutterman. He said of the scene at Spangler, "The barn more resembled a butcher shop than any other institution. One citizen ongoing near it fainted away and had to be carried off." If you combine the number of wounded at Grant Schoolhouse with the number of wounded at the 11th Corps Hospital, and the Spanglers hosted almost 3,000 wounded men on their farm, far surpassing the 2,400 population of Gettysburg at the time. That's just almost 300, again, just on one farm. Surgeons at Spangler were among the best of the best at their time, and they saved far more lives than they lost. Many went on to national leadership roles. But just like the soldiers, these surgeons were taken prisoner. They were wounded, they got sick, and they suffered. Many Spangler surgeons died young because of their exposure to disease, their horrifying work, poor food, long marches, and unsanitary camp life. Spangler surgeon Dr. Henry Van Arnhem, 154th New York, was a passionate opponent of slavery, and he wanted full civil rights for blacks. He said, "The curse of God visits on all that come in contact with this atrocious institution." Dr. Van Arnhem served four terms as United States Congressman. Spangler surgeon Dr. Henry K. Knapp, 153rd Pennsylvania, was sick with pneumonia as he cared for others at Spangler, and he died not long after the war at age 45. Spangler surgeon Dr. Jay Kling, 55th Ohio, was captured by Confederate cavalry while he was on his way home after being mustered out in Georgia in 1864, and he was imprisoned for 3 months. He filed a claim to the government for losses sustained and expenses incurred, but was denied because he was taken prisoner after he was mustered out. Finally, the Spanglers. The 11th Corps wounded continued to be sent away until the Spanglers finally got their farm back on August 7th, at least what was left of it. George Spangler filed three damage claims with the state and federal governments, totaling about $5,000, but they received a grand total of only $90. And it's believed that the entire $90 went to their Washington, D.C. attorney. So the Spanglers got nothing. This was common in Gettysburg. They even formed commissions. How are we going to get them to pay us? Some landowners got paid, but most of them didn't. The U.S. quartermaster. master's agent said, the government of the United States is no more responsible for bringing down the battle fought there than it would have been had a tornado passed over that country, causing its widespread destruction, as did that terrible engagement. That battle and hospital damage was his misfortune. The top left photo is one of the only few known photos of immediate Spangler family members. That's Benaiah, that's the young son. His wife Sarah and his daughter Mary Elizabeth. Mom and dad had moved away to a farm next door at this point. Benaiah was in charge of the farm now. You can see how well the Spanglers added on after the battle. They were a family of means, and they were able to add on even though they were rejected by the government. Their house during the battle is that big right there. So they added on all that by 1870. Their smokehouse is here, no refrigeration obviously in the 1860s, so they salt and smoke their wheat, their meat over a low fire. The nice picket fences always go up around the house. This is their outhouse. The summer kitchen where Armistead died had a grape arbor on it. So the Spanglers would grow their grapes there, and they would use sit under the grapes for shade when doing chores. And here's the oven that they used to stick dough through to make bread and other outbuildings, and then the big farm that hosted so many men with the amputations right over here. Daniel is one of the four kids. I found this photo after my book came out 3 years ago. But I'm doing another book, and this is going to be in that one. Daniel was the number three child, and he moved to Kansas so many years after the battle. This is his wife, Effie, and this photo was taken on their wedding day out in Kansas. The other known photos, I broke these photos out of this one. This is Grant's schoolhouse in 1884, 85. Notice it's like first grade through eighth grade. This is Benaiah, youngest child. He was 14 during the battle. This is Benaiah's child, Mary Elizabeth. This is his niece, Clara, and his niece, Alice, through his sister, Sabina. The teacher, you probably can't see it out there, is holding a ruler, some heavy wooden piece of some kind. We all know what she used that for. This is little Raphael Sherpy of the Peach Orchard family. Raphael's dad had already died, and as his dog, his dad had already died by the time this picture was taken. But Raphael, on his own, went on to become a distinguished and prominent dentist in Gettysburg, so he had a happy ending. George Spangler was chairman of the Cumberland Township School Board when he donated the land for Grant's schoolhouse in 1861. He also was a church in Adams County leader, serving on several boards, including the Evergreen Cemetery Board, that voted unanimously not to allow any Confederate burials there. A teacher whom George hired said, Mr. Spangler proved himself to be a very efficient school official and made a lasting impression on my mind as a man of truthfulness and honesty in all things. Elizabeth Spangler took care of her widower father in his later years and made sure he was buried next to George and Elizabeth. The Spanglers also took in a niece after her mother died. All four Spangler children became productive adults. Harriet and Sabina married local farmers and worked hard and had families, and their descendants today. I'm organizing a Descendants Day reunion at the farm on June 4th, and their Harriet and Sabina's descendants, all of them, are some of the finest people I know. Daniel moved to Kansas, so he's only going to have two people at Descendants Day. Sabina and Harriet are going to have over 40 total between them. They stayed around. Daniel moved to Kansas to use his carpentry skills in the growing new state, and he settled near Abilene about the time of Waldo Hickok was there battling Ronnie Cowboys. He gave up farming in about 1890 and moved into Gettysburg. And does anybody here know where Mr. G's ice cream is on Baltimore Street? That was Benaiah's. That was Benaiah's house when he moved into town, and that's where his mom, Elizabeth, daughter Harriet died 2 months after he died.
Excuse me.
Then Harriet's daughter Annie died a few days after her mother. So Elizabeth lost her husband, a daughter, and a granddaughter in 2 months. One of Daniel's two sons drowned in Kansas. And Benaiah's only grandchild died as a toddler. Okay, last slide. You can see what the barn looked like when the Gettysburg Foundation purchased the property in 2008. They spent $1.85 million to preserve the farm, and then they had to spend another million or more to put it into mint 1863 condition, which they did. Even the floor of the stable had 3 feet of manure from one end of it to the other, and it had rotted beams, so they actually had to replace some beams because of the manure. But most of the wood in that barn, the majority of the wood is original. Some of the wood goes back to a log cabin barn that was on the property starting in the 1700s. George recycled that log cabin barn into this barn, and if you come visit Spangler, you can see the 1700s wood. Now that the foundation has it fixed up, June, July, first 2 weeks of August, Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays, it opens the farm. Anybody can come. Living historians are there, volunteer guides are there. I'm one of the guides there. Check the place out. Hear the firsthand stories of what happened there. In fact, if you guys ever want to get really ambitious, I offer private group tours of the farms of the groups I speak to. So you can let me know if that's something you want, an hour and a half to 2 hour tour exploring Spangler Farm. I'm going to close with one more slide. I want to share two thoughts from Spangler 11th Corps Hospital worker Private James R. Middlebrook of the 17th Connecticut. He wrote to his wife Frances from Spangler, "It is enough to make one's heart bleed to witness the amputations. I feel it my duty to do all I can for them. I cannot see them suffer and shall stay as long as I can stand it." So Private Middlebrook survived until the end of the Civil War. And after nearly 3 years of service and all those battles and all that movement all over the East Coast, it was the fight in Gettysburg and his work in the Spangler Hospital that Middlebrook remembered most in his letters home before being mustered out. He wrote, "Make up your mind to travel some when we get home. I think of going to that place long to be remembered, Gettysburg." Fredericksburg, thanks so much for having me here tonight. This has been a real treat for me.
Do you have any questions?